I would like to welcome our guest speaker at this time, the Reverend Steve Atkins. He is the pastor of the People's Church of Divine Prophecy. This church was started by Reverend Atkins and others to provide a place of open spiritual worship. Steve has demonstrated clairvoyance, lectured on two continents, and works in an intimate fashion with the spirit realm. His experience covers more than 27 years and multiple disciplines of the physical and the spiritual. Please welcome Steve Atkins.
Morning, everyone.
Morning.
I'd like to take this moment to thank everyone for coming on this special holiday. I really love what's going on with this place because each one of you are helping to make this dream come true. It wasn't just me that started this church. It's all of y'all that have come. The lilies were somebody's suggestion. The candles were somebody's suggestion. Just everything you see here, somebody has contributed because they wanted to see this place grow and be part of it. So I just want to thank you for your continuing love of this place and support of it. Today I'm going to speak about life and death. And that's a very varied subject. I'm going to approach it from a spiritualist point of view, as that's what I primarily am, as a spiritualist. And I'm going to start it off with playing a soundtrack from this movie that was just funny as the Dickens, called Oh Brother, Where Art Thou? But it's not that funny of a song. It's sung by a real old-time bluegrass guy, Ralph Stanley. So let me play that a minute.
Oh, the young, the rich are poor,
human beings, this is a lot of what we see in death if we don't have a spiritual belief system to get us past that actual act of someone dying. Generally, when we see someone passing away, this is what we see as the physical releasing of the spirit and the soul. And it's a bit challenging and a bit depressing at times. But as we have a spiritual belief system that we draw to, we're able to put this into perspective at some time. Easter is a time of proof of survival of the grave, with Christ rising and appearing to people. As a spiritualist, we believe that everyone does that, not just Christ. We believe that you immediately transcend the grave when you die, that you are able to appear to your loved ones, that you are able to be at your own funeral, that you are able to console your loved ones, if nothing else other than letting them feel your presence after you pass. As a mental medium, I've done thousands of readings demonstrating the continuity of life after death. Not proving it, but demonstrating it. The proving is up to the person and how they receive it. Easter is a wonderful time, and I'll read a little bit about what the spiritualist Lyceum says, how spiritualists feel about Easter. The 31st of March is the anniversary of time when we learned our friends continued living and loving after physical death. This is when most spiritualists observe Easter, is March 31st. It was an Easter to know the grave. It was an Easter to know the grave did not hold the souls of dear ones. They were not doomed forever. And to celebrate, they assist us in all that makes us better and true to all goodness. What should be our lesson for Easter? Keep the doors of our hearts open so our spirit friends can help us and help those on earth. Make us more kindly and gentle toward everyone. Think of the good. Renew the memories of whatever good there has been done in the physical. Even by the weakest, thus resurrect the beauty of inner life. That song that we sang, For the Beauty of the Earth, that's traditionally the spiritualist national anthem, for lack of a better term. When spiritualism was first developed, it was actually a society of free thinkers. It was not a religious organization. It was in June 10th, 1854, I wrote it down, but now I can't find my paper. I got too many notes up here. But that was when it was first formed, and in the beginning, it had a lot of the higher end of society in it. This first organized society of spiritualists consisted of Governor Talmadge of Wisconsin, Judge Edmonds of the state court. There's a lot of people like that involved in spreading spiritualism in the beginning days. And somebody asked me today, I forget who it was, what happened with spiritualism? Why has it declined so much when it was so great at one time? And at one time, the Congress in the 1800s appropriated something like $20,000 to study the phenomenon of spiritualism, but that report ever produced, I haven't been able to find. But it was sweeping the country in such great fashion that they wanted to understand what it was. Spiritualism originally, as I said, was developed by societies of free thinkers. It was not intended to be a religion. It only became a religion when the practitioners of it and the people that espoused and supported it began to be attacked, jailed, and have all kinds of bad things happen to them when they would espouse this kind of philosophy. So they finally organized together as a religion. And the way the Bible got connected to spiritualism is that at that time you had to avow a certain known religious book of the time. You couldn't write your own and have it be what validated your religion. So spiritualists, primarily being breakaway Methodists, decided to embrace the Bible as the holy book. But they take the Bible as much symbolically, more symbolically than they do literally. What spiritualists believe about Jesus Christ, that's a big question. We consider him one of the greatest medium, healers, teachers, and spiritual leaders that the world has ever known. One who knew and applied natural law to the greatest extent of any human soul who has ever lived. Christ brought through the first golden rule. Until then, it was the rule of iron. An eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. Christ was the first one to bring through a religion based on love, based on doing good to others, regardless of what they did to you. So, as a spiritualist, I find the humanity of Christ what I draw to, rather than the divinity of Christ. Spiritualism is not a Savior God-based religion, even though we believe in Christ and the other Saviors that were sent to the earth. We look at them as teachers and guides, more so than somebody to save us from sin. Now, before I go any further, what I'm saying contradicts a lot of current religions. That does not mean that spiritualism doesn't believe these other religions that have value or are true. Spiritualism has no claim of exclusivity, which means we don't say we are the way. We say we are a way. We are inclusive, not exclusive. People of all faiths are welcome here. They're welcome to speak on this podium. We have a lot of different people from different things, different places that speak here. And that is also in keeping with one of the spiritualist principles. And that principle is to encourage lectures on all subjects pertaining to the spiritual and secular welfare of mankind. To protest against every attempt to compel mankind to worship God in any particular or prescribed manner, and to promote and advocate spiritual healing. I guess the simplest way to draw an analogy to it is that God is the universal music. People choose to dance to that in all different ways to get to that source. If you like to dance a waltz, you're not going to mix breakdancing up with it in the middle of it. Does that mean breakdancing is wrong? Absolutely not. Does that mean that waltzing is wrong? Absolutely not. Each individual draws to a particular spiritual philosophy to move them along their life's path. Within these prescribed systems, there are certain spiritual challenges that you will encounter as you embrace these truths, as you move down these paths. Sometimes the challenge causes you to change religious theologies to another theology to find an answer you can't find in that theology. Sometimes it reinforces the theology that you're in. Basically, spiritualists, there's three kinds of development on the face of the earth for spiritual development. One is called the singular method, which is where you yourself and your own intellect are what guides you in daily life. That's what a lot of people tend to draw to until they find a religion they find comfortable with. I did that for quite a while. The drawback to that that I found for myself is that it is limiting. No matter how smart you are, no matter how good you look at things, you're still trapped within your own emotional set of values and your own physical limitations, because you're not acknowledging something greater than yourself. Yeah, there's a God out there, but I don't think he has that much to do with me. That was my general attitude when I was coming up through that stage. Then there's the stage of subjective development, where there's a fixed theology, and you subject your belief system to be confined within the limits of that theology. And that theology is not limited to a secular name. You can't limit that to Christianity, because I've seen people do it with spiritualism. I've seen people have that same limited approach. My guide says this, my guide says that. I don't do anything today unless my guide talks to me. I can't get out of bed unless I got a specific crystal in my pocket. And everything that I think comes from God. I'm not responsible for any of my own thoughts. This is that approach. I'm talking about approaches, not names of religions. The third methodology is called co-development, which is what most spiritualists employ and most, a lot of other people employ. This means me, myself, and my own intellect, inspiration from God, that I believe there is a God, and the reactions that I have with the people that I'm involved in a day-to-day basis based on my perception of that through my own intellect and through my spiritual philosophy. This is what most people do, whether they really admit it or not. It's a very well-rounded approach. It keeps you balanced. It keeps you honest. And it's really what the way that things work. Best for me, anyway. As I keep doing, and Deepak Chopra talks about the same thing, self-referral, not external referral. Keep doing self-referral. And this was also a philosophy as I was coming up trying to get sober at about 35, the organization I was part of. It was constantly self-referral, looking at yourself, looking at your own thoughts, because your thoughts and your ideas lead you where you end up. So if those thoughts and ideals are spiritually tempered, have a spiritual perspective to them, you're going to be led places that you can't figure out on your own. There's going to be these solutions out of the blue. There's going to be this wonderful sense of comfort about life while you're just sitting in your chair. These are the things that spiritual discipline brings into your life. And it does not matter if it is Christian, if it is Buddhist, if it is spiritualist. Any philosophy practiced through the proper approach can produce harmony in your life. So I don't want anybody to think that by what I'm saying about spiritualism is putting any down or lessening any other belief system that you may hold, that you may have been part of. Half my family is atheists. My two brothers are pure atheists. I don't believe you live after you die. The rest of my entire family, 50 cousins, aunts, and uncles, are all devout Catholics. I've been that way for 10 generations. But what I found interesting was my immediate family, my brothers and sisters and my mom, all came to my ordination about 15 years ago in Casadega. And they sat out there and they applauded me and they smiled at me and they loved it because they saw the change that it had produced in my life. It had produced an honest, visible change to them where for 20 years, through prisons, through drug abuse, through alcohol abuse, I had stayed the same to them. No matter what system I used, no matter what consequences I suffered in my life, physically and emotionally, I never changed. When I began to embrace the philosophy of this organization to get clean and sober, it started sounding a lot like spiritualism too, because about two years after being in this organization, I found myself in Casadega sitting in there listening to lectures, and it sounded just like they were quoting the big book to me, some of them. Because the whole premise for this organization to get you sober and clean is that you have a spiritual awakening. If you don't have a spiritual awakening, you're not going to stay straight. Period. You have to have a shift in your values. You have to have something of a better life in your mind to look at and draw to. So after a while, I stopped going to the meetings of the other group because I found a bit of resentment about some of the things that were going on in there. And it was my issue, not theirs. But again, you reach these points within the philosophy you're following. You make a decision and you either amend your philosophy or you conquer the issue that you have in front of you. Whatever you are, know what you believe. Be able to state what you believe. Spiritual beliefs are not religious beliefs. Religious beliefs are what allows you to express it, most of what you believe spiritually, not all of what you believe. Rarely will you find a religious system that allows you to express your full belief in spirituality. And I see that all the time. the Christian Bible, as I know quite well, because I almost became a priest at 17, states that when you die, your body goes in the ground and stays as it did until the rapture. But there isn't hardly 1 in 10 Christians that don't believe that their loved ones come back to them after they passed away, don't believe they haven't had dreams about them. The Irish Catholics even have ballads about the husband and wife becoming reunited on the universal plane and living through all of eternity together once they pass. So there is this golden thread that is common through all religions, a belief of survival of the grave in some fashion. And each person takes that belief and modifies it to their own personal belief system, how they embrace it, what they embrace it for. Spiritualists believe that there is a God, one God, not multiple gods. We encourage people to have their own idea of what that God is and have a personal experience by that. We don't try to tell you what our idea of God is, because you are guided by that relationship on a one-to-one basis. That's how we believe spiritual development works. You can believe in intermediaries like guides and angels, but you don't have to. You can believe in direct communication with God if you would like to. I know a number of people that do that. And a lot of very good mediums say, I don't have a clue who my guides are. And that's part of spiritualism, is to believing in a band of guides that works with you in specific fashions. But the bottom line with spiritualism, what it used to say, and it should still say, is in order to be a spiritualist, you have to believe at some point in the philosophy that you transcend the grave, the personality survives the change called death, and this is demonstrated by the talent of mediumship. That's all it takes to consider yourself a spiritualist in the simplest sense. So people have made it a lot complicated, more complicated than it used to be, as is the way of organizations. But this philosophy literally saved my life. It literally brought me out of what I would call hell, even though spiritualists don't particularly believe in hell. We don't believe that there's a deity on the other side of life projecting these organized efforts to condemn you and make you do the wrong thing. Our belief in that is that you fight your own human instincts, your own human emotions, versus the spiritual inspiration that's in your life, and try to transcend what happens to you in the physical through a belief in a loving God that guides you and helps you move past the things that are in your life. One of the most interesting things that I had revealed to me, I feel, was when I was, you know, there's a little thing here that in the 24-hour book that I read, Ronnie called it my little book last year. When trouble comes, do not say, why should this happen to me? Leave yourself out of the picture. Think of other people and their troubles and you will forget about your own. Gradually get away from yourself and you will know the consolation of unselfish service to others. After a while, it will not matter so much what happens to you. It is not so important anymore. Some of that probably works and some of it probably doesn't, but it's worth thinking about. You think about things that don't really, you don't understand all of it, so you can move past it. But one of the most interesting things that I got in meditation was that if you readily embrace God as being the organizer of the wonderful and happy things in your life, why would you not believe that God is also the organizer of the challenging things that happen in your life? God is there both times, and if you can see God in the challenging times, then you will be able to definitely see God in the happy times. But that's the trick of seeing where God's trying to lead you when the difficult times come. That's the real truth of your spiritual belief, your real truth of your connection to God, when you become ill, when your loved ones become ill, when your financial situations start crashing down, and everything starts challenging you, that is when you really find out what you believe and what you don't believe. And that's not the purpose of these things. Opportunities is what they are. Opportunities to strengthen, to see a side you would not see. If I did not see the difficulties that I have seen in my life, I would be unable to work as a pastor. All I would be doing is reading a book and mouthing words. I feel the things that I say. I've experienced the things that I say. And the truth of that is in the energy that I say them with. These things are what help people. These are the way you can help other people. It doesn't matter if you've had difficult lives or not. You are put with other people to speak to. You find yourself encountering other people so that you can say something meaningful to them, even if it's only 5 words and you never see them again. This is part of the co-development, a random act of kindness. You will remember those things more than you will remember an organized effort to help somebody. They will come back to you time and time again, and you realize the times that you said to people, you will never, ever be able to really gauge the effect you've had on people. And I remember this because when I was with that organization for about 15 years trying to get sober, I went to a couple of state conferences. We organized a group to go into county jails, and we got a state senator to get a clearance of it. Because until then, each county jail you went to, each state prison you went to, you had to have clearances. So as a result, one or two people would get burned out doing the meetings there. So we organized together, got a state senator to get together and get a state clearance. And we went to a state conference and explained all this, and we took it nationally and used it as a national pattern with the organization. But the point is that when I was speaking at this conference, I had said that, I had mentioned at the end of the 30-day detox, you get this big book, and everybody signs it, puts their phone number in it, kind of like a yearbook. And I had said, if you don't think that this is serious, if you don't think trying to stay straight is serious, wait a year and call every name in front of that book and see how many have made it. If you don't think this is a hard thing to do and a serious thing to do, just pick that book up and call every phone number in there and see how many are still making it. And this one guy, I saw him about a year later, he says, you don't remember me. He said, but you spoke at a conference I was at. You said something that really changed my life. And I said, really, what was it? And I thought it was going to be this big, profound thing, a big book, some huge thing somebody else wrote. And he said, that thing you said about the big book, he said, it really kept me, it got me straight. I said, oh, you stayed sober the whole time? He said, no, I drank like hell for about a year. He said, and I woke up one day after a real bad bout of drinking, and I saw that book laying on its side on the floor, and I picked it up and called every name in there like you said. He said, that sobered me right back up, and I've been sober ever since. So you don't have to have a lot of book learning to help people. Your life's experience can help people at any time, anywhere, regardless of what you think of it. Take the time to speak to people. Take the time to spread a little peace in people's lives, which is what this season is all about. And it's really interesting because I saw a full moon on Good Friday. How long has it been since we've seen a full moon on Good Friday? Whatever you believe, whatever religion you embrace, I can't remember the last time. And for those of you that don't know how they figure when Easter Sunday is, it's the first Sunday after the first full moon, after the 21st of March. So how, you wonder, when the Catholic Church wrote that up, if there was actually a full moon on the first Good Friday? I mean, that's really something to think about. Because regardless of what you believe about the divinity of Christ, he was real. And he really did the things that he said, that they say he did. But whether the rest of it, you know, there's a lot of things that people said about him that may not be true about him. But he as an individual really did the things that he said he did. And it was a very changing thing in the world at that time as to what happened. very pivotal figure in the history of the world. I've about ventured here enough. That's pretty much the tenets of spiritualism and how I would approach life and death. We believe that you transcend life, death, immediately into a new life. That it's not that you move into what would be considered heaven. And there's a lot of mixed stories about what people see when they go to the other side. But I can say honestly, out of the thousands of mediumistic readings I've been bringing back through loved ones, not once has anybody ever described being in suffering. Not once has anybody ever described being in pain of any kind. They have always come back with a broader view, with a more loving view, no matter what they were. And I've brought through abusers to their daughters, abusers to their wives. I never brought through a murderer to anybody. Well, I guess I did one time. I did. But it doesn't matter what you've done here. When you go to the other side, you go through a school, and you still have to. There's a balancing of things. Some of it is through the way that you pass. Some of it is through personal realizations on the other side. People say, well, what about people like Hitler? Well, what I believe, and a large number of people believe, is they think that they're still sleeping while they're over there. When they die, they think that they're asleep. They're dreaming. And what happens is all of the angels, all of the healing influences draw around them and begin to project healing and upliftment to that soul until they wake up and realize what's going on and what's happening. You don't just immediately wander around with everybody else because you, no matter what kind of person, as you believe here, you will have more freedom on the other side. As you act here, you will have more freedom on the other side. It's similar to a guy standing in, two people standing in Times Square. One's illiterate, one's literate. Who's going to be able to read more and take in more standing on the corner of Times Square just by what the virtue and what they know? Or two people standing on the shore of a lake. One can swim, the other can't. Who's going to be able to do more at the lake? It's just a natural law of how you develop. So I would leave you with this thought today, that in this season of life and rebirth, take a moment today to look back over your life, to give yourself the gratitude for the things that you have, not the things that you don't have. Enjoy things. Me and my wife had a real difficult conversation a few days ago. She was really upset because our money's getting tight. I've had to pay out a lot of money for these medical bills. I've made some stupid decisions on other things. And our money is short. And I said, don't worry about the bills until we can't pay it. Don't worry about the bills we can't pay until they come and can't be paid. Let's just, everything's staying paid now. So let's don't worry about what we can't pay until we can't pay it. You know, take it easy on yourself. And, you know, that's what you have to remember. Each day is what the gift is. Not next week, not next year. Each day is the only gift you have, and we see that all the time. I mean, we knew that fella Tom Walsh pretty well, that got killed in that bar in Durant. You think that he ever thought that was going to be his last day? My neighbors that have passed away with sudden illnesses, you ever think they thought that was going to be their last day? They were planning for the future. Life turns on a dime. People pass away every day from known and unknown things. Enjoy your life today. Enjoy the very breath that you have in your body. Enjoy the opportunity that God gives you to be in contact with other people. How many people are housebound and never see another human being? And here we are mumbling because we're stuck in a long line in the grocery store. Start talking to them.